And you mentioned that Luther Calvin differed from Augustine. So is there a third point of view? I mean, obviously you're saying there's lots of other points of view within these perspectives.
So I've had a chance to spend a lot of time with Augustine on this question, which is really enjoyable. And you'll see I have there's towards the end of the book, there's a very lengthy Augustine footnote on this and the way that he goes and he uses what I call the early perspective tradition, the way that he appropriates that and then in a sense goes and transposes that in the context of the Pelagian controversy. So Pelagius, he's arguing back and forth about, you know, the nature of salvation, everything like that. And it's interesting because you have a debate which is, you know, which is originally between sort of, you know, Jews and Gentiles, or, you know, kind of Gentile Christians, or a mixed body of, you know, of Christians versus, you know, versus Jews on the other side. And so you have that debate, and then when in Augustine's context, it's transposed into a debate about salvation between just Christians. So the you know when he's engaging these texts versus Pelagius, the Jewish question has sort of fallen out of sight, and it's sort of transposed into a new debate. And so the debate with Pelagius becomes, you know, are there, and some of this is hard because with Pelagius, when we're trying to reconstruct his views, it's notoriously difficult because on the one hand, Pelagius doesn't always seem like he is represented in the most fair and accurate way. It's usually most of what we have is, you know, preserved by the people who disagreed with him. But then he also seems to be a bit slippery, which is interesting historically how it seems like Augustine is, you know, frustrated by this. He'll be on trial in the East, and they'll go on to ask him a question, and he'll be like, oh yeah, I believe that. That's fine. Or I'll go and I'll condemn that proposition. And Augustine, you know, way off and like, no, he doesn't actually believe that. What's wrong with you guys? How could you let him off with this lie? And so it's really interesting. But what it seems as though what it comes down to is that Pelagius wants to go and have the door open for there being works that we can do that justify us apart from God's grace. And that's really what Augustine is wanting to go and shut the door to. He's wanting to go and shut the door to the idea that anything that we do apart from God's grace can be justifying before God. Now, whether we consider that in the sense of, you know, meriting forgiveness or going and, you know, God actually making us righteous through these things, kind of table that question as far as what we actually mean about the nature of justification there. Augustine, the thing he's really trying to do there is to close the door on Pelagius, that anything that we do, you know, apart from God's, you know, sanctifying grace in our lives, could go and merit the grace of salvation. And so he then, the way that he looks at this dichotomy is he kind of looks at, you know, works of the law as anything done apart from God's grace. And then he goes and he contrasts that, you know, with faith or works of faith. And that's anything that's done that's empowered by God's grace. So then it's interesting for Augustine, you can still have works be justifying, but they have to be works done that are empowered by God's grace, because otherwise they don't there's no merit there, and there's nothing that we can do apart from his grace to, you know, be able to do anything that actually is, you know, avails anything before God. It's interesting how and if this is too much inside baseball for you, feel free to just
This is
pass it
fantastic.
out. There's
I'm just taking notes here, and I'm separating apart from God's grace versus empowered by God's grace. I'm just having these two categories.
It's really interesting. And so the way that he goes and conceives of that, he kind of transposes it into this new context. Now there's two things to say out of this. One is that when it comes to sort of the Augustinian perspective in relation to what you would call, you know, the early perspectives, they're still broadly compatible in that it's not like the early perspectives are saying, hey, all these works done apart from God's grace are, you know, meritorious. It just locates the particular debate in the context of the Jew-Gentile issue that Paul is talking about in, you know, Romans and Galatians. And so it's pretty easy to go and to regard them as compatible and to understand them as sort of, you know, mutually going, holding together a theological reality. The other thing that you should say that you have to kind of acknowledge that. Augustine himself, he doesn't abandon what we would call the early perspective, because outside the context of this Pelagian controversy, so towards the end of his life, after he's sort of, you know, done, beating Pelagius with a shovel or whatever, and this all these disputes, towards the end of his life, he has this little treatise called An Answer to the Jews. And what's fascinating is that here he continues to go and to say the early perspective stuff that he's, you know, said kind of early on in his career when he's outside of the context of the Pelagian controversy. So once the debate is back to a debate between Christians and Jews, he sounds just like these early figures, like, you know, like Justin Martyr or Irenaeus or Ignatius of Antioch or Origen, or and then you know, going forward, it sounds a lot like N.T. Wright as well, and these figures that we're calling the new perspective. And so it's important to go and to see in Augustine's own thought that even where it goes and develops, it doesn't develop in a way that is incompatible with the views that you could say the early interpreters held. It's just he's engaging a new problem, a new issue within the context of the Pelagian controversy. And so it's kind of, to take Calvin as one example, Calvin sets his position both in distinction to this, you know, what we call the early perspective, so what he identifies with, you know, with Origen, Chrysostom, Jerome, and both Luther and Calvin, they'll often say Jerome is, or not sorry, Jerome, they'll often say that Origen is kind of the big guy who goes and gets everything wrong, because in their own historical context, Origen's commentary on Romans is the earliest interpretation of this stuff that they have, and they both tend to look at this and say, we think this is wrong. And so they kind of pin, you know, all the errors on Origen and say, hey, he must have messed things up, which is really interesting, because, you know, having more access to historical sources now, we can actually look at Origen and say, he instead of doing something new, he's actually going and just saying what everybody before him said. So mm-hmm. Origen is being a, you know, a traditionalist rather than an innovator in this area. The second thing is, so that's the early position that Calvin is kind of putting his own view and distinction towards. And then the second one is the Augustinian one. And that one as well, he wants to go and to say his view is distinct from. And so the idea that the works done that are, you know, empowered by God's grace, that those are justifying in some kinds of way. That's Calvin looks at it and says, I don't agree with that either. So anyway, I hope that's not too much inside baseball for you. But
well, I got to, you know, well, the good thing about a podcast, I can re-listen and pause to think through everything you just said, because there was a lot to take in.
Hey, thank you so much for checking out this video clip from the Dogado podcast. To get more videos like this, simply subscribe here on YouTube. You can also download the full episode of each show on iTunes, Spotify, Google Play, or your favorite podcast player. Take care.